Hello everyone, how are you all? This is your educator G. Vijaya Manorama. So welcome to my channel Vijaya Manorama Tutorials. So subscribe my channel, all of you. So this is the best channel for all the class 10th students. So term 1 syllabus I have covered totally. This is the last chapter of term 1, metals and non-metals related to physics and bio also. All the links were there in the description box. You can just go through with that. So next class onwards, we are going to do like a marathon of all the multiple choice questions related to each and every chapter. Okay, so let us start the chapter. So here we are going to discuss about metals, non-metals. So metallurgy part is removed. So about metals and non-metals, all the physical properties, chemical properties of metals and non-metals, and ionic compounds, how ionic compounds are formed. Okay, so totally how many elements are there? There are 118 elements. Out of 118 elements, if you see, 80% are metals only. So many usable materials on the earth are metals, and only 19 elements are there which are non-metals in the elements. Okay, so the metals which are used in our daily life, like iron, copper, aluminium, lead, nickel, chromium, silver, gold, mercury, zinc, all these things we are using, but we don't know what are the physical properties and what are the chemical properties. In the examination point of view, in the subject point of view, we are going to learn about this in this session today. Okay, metals being their very important natural resource, which plays a very key role in the history of civilization. Okay, so the elements, actually they are classified into metals, non-metals and metalloids or semi-metals. On the basis of their chemical properties only, these things are divided. So the metals which appear on the left hand side and middle part of the periodic table, and the non-metals, they appear at the right hand side of the periodic table. There are 19 non-metals, and out of their 7 are solids, 11 are gases, and only 1 is liquid at the room temperature. So what is that non-metal which is liquid at the room temperature? If you know, you just write down in the comment section. Okay, it is bromine. Okay, so these, whatever we are discussing, so each and every sentence in the form of multiple choice question you may get. So just make a notes of that also. So since non-metals, they exist as solid, liquids and gases, they exhibit in a wide range of physical properties in comparison to the metals. So there are 6 elements like silicon, germanium, strontium, pterillium, which exhibits the property of metals as well as non-metals. They are called as semi-metals. Okay, they show both the properties. At present, there are 92 metals in the periodic table. Okay, so what are the properties of the metals? Let us find out. Metals are solids. Their physical state is always, they are solid at room temperature except mercury. So there is an exceptional in each and every case. So here, generally all the metals are in solid state only at the room temperature except mercury. Mercury is in liquid state. Come to the hardness part. If you see, metals are generally hard except the alkali metals like sodium, potassium. These all, they are very soft, which we can cut with a knife also easily. So the hardness varies from metal to metals. Okay, so you have to remember this. Lithium, potassium and sodium are very soft, we can cut with the knife. Okay, that's why they are very much reactive. In the reactivity series also we are going to learn, they are very much reactive with the atmosphere. That's why always we keep the sodium and potassium in the kerosene. So that is a very, very important question. In which liquid we can store sodium and potassium? It is kerosene. Okay, next come to the tensile strength. If you see, metals possess high tensile strength. They can resist to stretching without any breaking. So metals are lustrous, they are malleable. What is malleability? If you see, it can be beaten into thin sheets. They are ductile. Ductility is the nature. What is ductility? It can drawn into wires. Okay, so metals have high melting points. Gallium and cesium, they have very low melting points. Even they can melt if you keep that in the hand also. Okay, so metals are sonorous, they can produce sound. If you see the brass bell which is kept in the temples, whenever you hit, it produces the sound also, no? So that is also an easy example. metals have high boiling points. Metals are good conductors of heat. They are the best conductors also present in the metals, copper and silver. Silver is the best conductor of heat. Okay. So poor conductors are lead and mercury comes under poor conductors. So density, the densest metal is osmium and the lightest metal is lithium. Lithium is the lightest metal and osmium is the densest metal. Okay, so density point of view also you need to remember. So different densities also we can discuss, but no need to. Osmium is 22.7 is the density, whereas lithium is 0.54. okay, so metals have high melting point. Gallium, cesium, they have low melting points. Next, metals have very high boiling points. They are good conductors of heat. Metals are good conductors of electricity. So best conductors are silver and copper. Okay, malleability, ductility, high point of view, high melting point, boiling point. So whereas if you see gold is the most malleable metal and silver is the most ductile metal. So these two things you need to remember. Next, come to the physical properties of non-metals. If you see non-metals, they are solids, liquids and gases. So bromine is always it is in the form of liquid. If you see the gases, oxygen, hydrogen and nitrogen, they are in the form of gases. So whereas some solids, if you see carbon, sulfur, phosphorus, these all are in the form of solids only and they are brittle also. So these non-metals are very soft except diamond, which is the hardest natural substance. So non-metals, they are not lustrous except iodine. In every case there is an exceptional. Those exceptionals only will be asked in the form of multiple choice questions. Okay, so except iodine crystals, all the non-metals are lustrous. So non-metals are not malleable, non-metals are not ductile. Non-metals which are solids and liquids have very low melting points. Non-metals which are solids and liquids have very low boiling point. They are bad conductors of heat. They are bad conductors of electricity. Whereas graphite, it is also a non-metal only, form of carbon. So, but it is a good conductor of electricity. Okay. Non-metals are not sonorous. If the hardness, if you see, non-metals are generally soft and brittle. Example here, we have taken sulfur and phosphorus. Next one is density. Non-metals are having very low density. The density of phosphorus and sulfur, if you see, 1.82 gram per ml and 2.06 ml. So these values you no need to, just you remember, low density non-metals have, non-metals which have low density, that is sulfur and phosphorus, you can take remember for the example. So non-metals have very low density. Allotropy, this is also another property of non-metals which can exist in more than one form. Okay, they are called as allotropy. So the different forms of elements, they are called as allotrophs. So carbon is the main thing which you can understand here. Carbon has various allotropic forms, among that diamond, graphite, Buckminster fullerenes, coke, lamp black. These all are another examples of that. This phosphorus also exists in 5 different forms. Sulfur also exists in some 4 different forms. It is also existing. So these all are the properties of, physical properties of non-metals. Okay. Now next thing is chemical properties. It is very, very important. So start making the notes also of all these things. So if you see the reaction with oxygen, how it is reacting with oxygen, how it is reacting with hydrogen, these all things we are going to discuss now. So chemical properties of metals, if you see, most chemical properties of metals arises due to their electropositive characters. Metals have electropositive character. Due to this electropositive character, it shows so many chemical properties. and their chemical reactivity also, which we can explain due to this reactivity series only. So what is this electropositive character? If you see, what is this electropositive character? Electropositive character means tendency of losing their valence electrons. Okay, if suppose M is a gas, it can lose M plus ion it forms as it is losing one electron. Okay, so the arrangement of the metals in a vertical column in the order of decreasing reactivity series, that is called as activity series of the metal. So that is very very important. So chemical properties, first we'll learn reaction with the oxygen, after that I'm going to tell you the reactivity series. So metals, they react with oxygen to form the metal oxides. When copper is heated, it combines with oxygen to form copper oxide, so Cu plus O2 CuO. So to balance it, 2 Cu, and here also we'll balance. So next one is when aluminium is heated, it combines with oxygen to form aluminium oxide, Al plus O2, aluminium plus oxygen, Al2O3. So while writing the formula, very carefully you need to write down this, because most of the people are getting confusion here. Al2O2 they are writing. So some metal oxides are basic oxide because they react with water to form its bases. Okay, oxides of metals are either acidic or amphoteric. This is another nature that also we'll discuss now. So some metal oxides, they show acidic and basic properties. What is amphoteric oxides? Some metals, they show metal oxides show acidic and basic properties. That property is called as amphoteric. Amphoteric oxide. So aluminium oxide, zinc oxide will come under that. Al2O3, aluminium oxide. Here if you see, it is reacting with HCl. HCl is an acid. NaOH is a base. In both the cases, the reaction is taking place. In the acidic Al2O3, if you see, that is when reacting with the base, it will give NaAlO2 plus H2O. Sodium aluminate it is giving. Okay. So NaAl2. Here you can balance it here. Al2O3, 2 NaOH, here 2 NaAlO2 plus H2, sodium aluminate it is. Next, how it is reacting with hydrogen? I said it is water. Okay, so metals react with water to form metal oxides or metal hydroxides, and hydrogen it is forming. Okay, hydrogen is in the form of water when it is reacting. The reactivity of metals with water, that can be explained in terms of the activity series only. So potassium and sodium, they react vigorously with cold water by displacing the hydrogen. The reaction is highly exothermic and it evolves, the hydrogen catches the fire immediately. So that reaction, Na and water, sodium and water, if you see, this is the reaction. So calcium reacts with water less vigorously with the cold water. So the heat evolved that is not sufficient for hydrogen to catch the fire. The bubbles of hydrogen gas you can find. Next come to the magnesium. Magnesium does not react with the cold water. It reacts only with the hot water. Magnesium, Mg. Mg plus 2H2O gives rise to MgOH2 plus H2. Magnesium does not react with cold water. It reacts only with hot water to form magnesium hydroxide and hydrogen. So actually it starts floating on the surface of the water due to the bubbles of hydrogen gas which is sticking on the surface of the water. So metals like magnesium, aluminium, zinc, iron, these all they react with the steam. Okay, these all they react with the steam. So next one is tin lead, they react with superheated steam with great difficulty. Copper, mercury, silver and gold, these all things they won't react with water or steam at all. Okay, So here the activity of the reactivity of different metals with water, it is different. So just take the screenshot of this. Okay, copper, silver, gold, if you see, if the reaction they give in the multiple choice questions, there is no reaction with copper plus water. Silver plus water, there is no reaction. Okay, next one is reaction of metals with metal salt solutions. A more reactive metal will displace with least reactive metal from its salt solution. That is only displacement reaction. That is displacement reaction. So highly reactive metal will displace the least reactive metal. Okay, so for example, here it is given magnesium and copper sulfate. Magnesium is highly reactive than copper, so that's why it was displaced and formed magnesium sulfate. So zinc displaces copper from copper sulfate solution because zinc is highly reactive than copper. Next, iron will displace copper from copper sulfate solution. Here also the same thing, displacement reaction. The more reactive metal will displace the less reactive metal. Okay, so here some example, one more example I want to write here. Where is this cursor? So silver nitrate, if you see, AgNO3 plus copper, CuNO3 whole 2 plus 2Ag. Okay, silver, white color silver will separate. Copper nitrate, a blue color product is formed. As silver nitrate is colorless, a red color copper, these two will react and it will give a blue color of copper nitrate solution. Okay, and silver will is white in color only. So next come to the reactivity series. So this reactivity series you need to remember, very very important. The arranging of metals in the decreasing order of their reactivity, it is called as reactivity series of metals. So if you see here, potassium, sodium, calcium, magnesium, aluminium, zinc, iron, lead, hydrogen, copper, silver, sorry, mercury, silver, gold. So this is the reactivity series. The most reactive metal is up, the reactivity series is start decreasing when you come down. The arrangement of metals are in that order only, decreasing order of their reactivity. Okay, so this is called as reactivity series of metals. So in this only, small one more thing we have to discuss, that is aqua regia. Okay, what is aqua regia? Latin name is royal water, it is called as, right? Royal water, it is called as, 1 minute. Aqua regia, it is also called as royal water. Here it is a mixture of concentrated nitric acid and hydrochloric acid. They are in the ratio of 1:3. So most of the children, they confuse which one is 1 and which one is 3. You remember like this, HNO3 has 3, so it is 1. HCl has 1, so here it is 3. That is in the ratio of 1:3 by the volume. It is highly corrosive. So fuming liquid which is attacking many substances which remains unaffected by other reagents. Okay, although concentrated nitric acid or concentrated hydrochloric acid alone cannot dissolve gold, aqua regia can dissolve gold readily. That's why aqua regia, one of the few reagents it is, which can dissolve platinum and gold also. Okay, that's why very carefully we have to work with this. If it can, if it come in contact with the skin or and flesh, it may corrode the skin also. Understand? That's why very carefully we have to work with this. So this aqua regia is another important one. So this is the reactivity series. How metals and non-metals, they react, that is the main thing. Metals, they lose electrons and become positive ions. so they are called as electropositive elements. The atomic number of sodium is 11. It is very very important. So its electronic configuration, how you will write? 2, 8, 1. The valence electron is in the outermost shell, it is 1. So this metals can lose one electron and forms a sodium ion, that is Na plus. Okay. So non-metals, they gain electrons and become negative ions, that is electronegative elements, negative ions it forms. That's why they are called as electronegative elements. The atomic number of chlorine, if you see, it is 17. The electronic configuration is 2, 8 and 7. It has 7 valence electrons. It gains 1 electron and forms a chloride ion, that is Cl minus. Chlorine, here Cl minus ion it is formed. So why is it that the non-metals are electronegative in nature? Due to the presence of 5 to 7 electrons in the valence cells, the non-metals have a very strong tendency to gain electrons. To follow this octet rule, to become stable, it has the nature of gaining electrons. That's why they gain electrons readily and form electronegative elements, electronegative ions. Okay. So that's why non-metals are electronegative in nature. They cannot lose electrons easily to form positive ions. They are not electropositive in nature, they are electronegative in nature. So from this small topic, that electronegative elements, electropositive elements, it is a gunshot, two questions you will get. Okay, in the form of paragraph based question, case study based question, these all are there, no? There also you may have a chance of getting such questions. Okay, formation of sodium chloride molecule, it is also another. How this bonding is taking place, that you need to understand. Here, sodium and chlorine. Okay, sodium we know, 11 is the electronic configuration, 7 is the, 11 is the atomic number. Electronic configuration, how you will write? 2, 8 and 1. Chlorine is 17, the electronic configuration is 2, 8 and 7. Okay, so here, so from sodium is losing one electron, which is received by chlorine. So it is also following the octet rule. To follow the octet rule, here one electron it is losing. So in the outermost shell, how many electrons are there? 8. So when you see here, in the outermost shell, only 7 electrons are there. When this one electron sodium has lost and gained by chlorine, so now the outermost shell, how many electrons were there? 2, 8 and 8. That's why now chlorine is also stable and sodium is also stable. That's why then the attraction between the sodium ion and chlorine ion will take place. And what is the result of that? It forms a molecule of sodium chloride. Okay. The formation of this, a compound which is formed by the transfer of these electrons from a metal to a non-metal, is called as ionic compound or electrovalent compound. Okay, and the bond which is formed is called as ionic bond or electrovalent bond. Okay, this bond is called as, not this bond, here bond is called as ionic bond. And the compound whichever is forming, sodium chloride, this is called as ionic compound, right? So few examples of ionic compounds are chlorides, fluorides, nitrates, oxides and sulfides of sodium and potassium, chlorides, fluorides, nitrates and oxides of magnesium and calcium. So these all are the examples. So what are the properties of ionic compounds if we see? So here another example, magnesium chloride molecule, how it is formed. Here also the atomic number is 12. So after this I will tell you the properties of ionic compound. Magnesium atomic number is 12. So electronic configuration we will write it as 2, 8, 2. So in the outermost shell, how many electrons are there? 2. So it will lose 2 electrons. Next one is chlorine. Atomic number is 17, 2, 8, 7. in the outermost shell 7 electrons are there, that's why it need one more electron to become stable. So here whatever the electrons, 2 electrons were lost, so that's why it will distribute to 2 chlorine. Okay, so here the atomic number of chlorine is 17, so here it gains 1 electron to form chlorine ion. So then the attraction between Mg2+, right, here Mg2+, that's why it is attaching with 2 chlorine ion, that is the result which gives the magnesium chloride molecule MgCl2. Okay, MgCl2. So what is the bond formed? The bond is ionic bond or electrovalent bond, and the compound which is formed, that is called as ionic compound or electrovalent compound. Okay, so what are the properties of these ionic compounds? Ionic compounds are generally solids only. They are hard due to the presence of strong electrostatic forces of attraction which is present in between the oppositely charged ions. They are brittle and their crystals that break into pieces on applying the pressure. Okay, this is the main thing which, so here is the properties. Ionic compounds are the compounds formed by the transfer of electrons from a metal to a non-metal. So the properties of ionic compounds are, they are formed by the transfer of electrons and they are made up of ions. They are crystalline solids. They have the very high melting points and boiling points. They are soluble in water but insoluble in organic solvents. Organic solvents like petrol and kerosene, they are called as organic solvents. So these ionic compounds are soluble in water but insoluble in organic solvents. Okay. So they conduct electricity in the molten state or in solutions. Okay. They conduct electricity in the molten state. Okay, the melting point and boiling points, solubility, electrical conductivity. Electrical conductivity, the ionic compounds, they conduct electricity in the aqueous solution and in the molten state. Okay, in the molten state, the heat energy, they break the inter-ionic or electrostatic forces which are present. That result, the ions are able to move freely and they conduct the electricity. Okay, so this is the topic. We don't have metallurgy part. So hope you like the session. Jitna jyada ho sake apne friends ke saath share karo bachcho. So I am coming with the multiple choice questions in the Google Forms also. You are going to get in the description box. Just answer and learn. Okay, so thank you. Stay safe and stay strong. Be strong and be confident. All the best, my dear children. Take care, all of you. Bye-bye.